My name is Daniel Chavez, and I'm very happy to be back in Athens. I was here some weeks ago for a quite happy occasion. I was here for the foundation or the refoundation of Greece's main left party, so it's always good to be back among friends. So the title of my presentation is the one that appears there, Lies On. And originally, I wanted to talk about the search for alternatives to privatization in Latin America, specifically in the electricity sector. My original title referred to struggles against privatization, but in the plane, I decided to change the focus of the presentation a bit and make it a bit more positive and try to focus on alternatives to privatization currently evolving in Latin America. I assume that you are a very well-informed group, that you know about the main political changes in Latin America, that you know about the rise of the new left and all that. So I'm not going to dedicate many minutes to talk about that. In any case, struggles and alternatives goes hand in hand. What you see here is a picture that I took in Mexico City in the year 2009. When 250,000 people took the streets of the main city of Latin America to defend one public electricity company that was being closed down by the government of Felipe Calderón, the by then president of Mexico. Since then, the workers' union has been resisting what they see as the liberalization of the energy sector and eventual privatization, and proposing viable alternative for public provision of power. Before I continue, let me clarify the place from which I'm talking. I'm talking as a member of TNI, but also as a member of the MSP, the Municipal Service Project. This is a global research network focused on alternatives to privatization, which is composed of both academic and social organizations. As you can see there, the MSP includes several universities, also some non-governmental research center, also trade unions and civic networks from all continents of the world. And we have been working on alternatives to privatization in the water, electricity, and health sector for the past year. The aim of our project, this is the website, is to develop conceptual and methodological tools that could allow comparative in-depth research on historical, contemporary, and proposed alternatives to service commercialization. Before I continue, I'm now entering into the focus of my presentation. Originally, I thought of this title for this presentation. I guess all of you who are above 40 years old remember this movie. It wasn't a really good movie, but we all loved it as children. And remember, there was a good guy, a bad guy, and an ugly guy. But in fact, the good guy was not always so good, and the ugly guy was not always that ugly. The bad was always bad. And I think a similar idea applies to the energy sector. It's quite easy to identify what is the bad guy, but it's not so easy to identify who is good and who is ugly or not. So let's begin with the ugly one. The first ugly is energy poverty. Some people already talk about that. That's the focus of my research within the MSP project, Electricity in the South, but other comrades within TNI have carried similar studies in Africa and Asia. I focus on Latin America. What you can see in this map, apparently, is that the situation in Latin America in relation to electricity is not that bad when we compare to Africa and Asia. The dark blue that covers most of the region means that the share of people without access to electricity services today is below 25%. In many countries of Africa and Asia, that number is well above 50%. However, access to electricity within Latin America is still highly unequal between urban and rural areas and between different class lines. And across the Latin American and Caribbean region, almost 30 million of people still do not have access to electricity. Still, our research indicates that Latin America is clearly the region of the South where the majority of alternatives to privatization can be found. The other ugly that I found in the energy sector in Latin America is the heavy reliance on dirty energy. What you see there is Latin America's primary energy matrix in the year 1970 in gray and in green in the year 2010. And as you can see there, Latin America still relies heavily on the use of dirty and environmentally and socially unsustainable sources of energy. You see there oil, you see natural gas that is growing, coal, hydroelectricity, which can be good, but is not always good. And in Latin America, we have a long history of very bad mega dams. Geothermal, that could be good, but it's also problematic. For instance, if we discuss that in Costa Rica, some people would not be so happy with that. Some countries are still relying on nuclear, bagasse, and others that also have to do with agrofuel. And when we look at the future, it seems that this matrix is not going to improve a lot. This is a forecast that was made by a specialist of OLADE, the Latin American Organization of Energy, which integrates governmental people from different countries. So let's move to the bad guys. And the bad guys are quite easy to identify in the electricity sector. The first one is privatization. Privatization has been a great business for transnational corporations, but quite an awful deal for the peoples of Latin America. I choose this picture that comes from Bolivia because some of the most intense struggles against privatization of public services have taken place in that country. Research showed that privatization responds to private business interests or purely ideological motives, and has not been a response to specific problems of public services delivery. And when we look at the numbers are quite impressive, especially in the golden years of privatization between the late 80s and the early 2000s. And you can see there that by far most of the money that was generated in the context of privatization was related to deals that took place in Latin America. Much behind are Central Europe and Central Asia, East Asia and the Pacific, South Asia, Middle East and North Africa, and Sub-Saharan Africa. Here I'm talking about the South. I'm not talking about Europe and in the North. This might look like a lot of money that governments got from privatization. But when we compare this number with the profit that private companies made out of these privatization deals, the comparison is quite negative for the side of the government. When we look at the different sectors that have to do with privatization, obviously much of the money that was circulated in the context of privatization have to do with telecommunications, but electricity comes second, then hydrocarbons, industrial sectors, mining, financial service, and other services. So when we add up electricity and hydrocarbons, oil and gas, we see that by far energy was the sector where most of the money that was circulated in the context of privatization came from. And this also applies to Europe. This is a picture that was recently published, but in fact, it's a mega study that takes data from different studies, and it shows that even here in the North, the money that circulated in the context of privatization was quite huge. We all know the legacy of privatization. I'm not going to talk in detail about that because we are all familiar with that. Higher rates, profit not invested locally, limited coverage of low-income areas, lower quality of services provision and health risk, loss of jobs for energy workers, lack of accountability and corruption, and expensive reversal of privatization deals. In many countries, governments that try to go back with privatization were taken to international court by private companies demanding compensation. And I guess our friend from Ecuador, for instance, can talk a lot about that, but also the Argentinians, the Bolivians, people and governments from many places in Latin America can talk about the same things. And the other bad that we found in this area are transnational corporations. Both European and American firms expanded internationally in the 1990s. For instance, in the case of Euro, it was mainly a French company, EDF, and Spanish companies, Endesa, Iberdrola, and Unión Fenosa. And in the case of American companies, we heard about Enron. You all remember the infamous Enron, AES, and other. But the interesting thing is that many of these companies withdrew after the year 2000. And there are many reasons that could explain why the private companies decided to leave the Latin American market. In some cases, there were lower profits than they had expected. And in other cases, there was quite a lot of public and political resistance. But this company also expanded in the north. Here, for instance, we see some of the European companies that expanded in the United States. And we see exactly the same actors that operated in Latin America. EDF of France, GDF Suez of France, E.ON, Iberdrola from Spain. So the same companies that are trying to get money out of privatization deals in the south are also active in the north. There is another bad in the energy sector that we don't usually talk a lot about, and I'm going to talk more about public enterprises in a minute, and that has to do with corporatization, because we tend to defend public enterprises. I'm a defender of public enterprises. I come from a country, Uruguay, where more than 70% of the people some years ago voted in a referendum against privatization. So I'm very proud of come from that country, which was the first that decided to defend public enterprises. But we also have to criticize some public enterprises. And for instance, we could talk a lot about these Latin American public enterprises. This is Empresas Públicas de Medellín, Public Enterprises of Medellín, which is an extremely efficient, extremely profitable public company that provides great services for both water and electricity in Medellin, is expanding to many places in Colombia, is expanding to other places in Central America and South America. But we can discuss how much public remains of this company, because it's a company that tends to operate like any other transnational corporation. In fact, it's becoming a new kind of transnational corporation that in Latin America we call multi-Latina. Those are the transnational corporations that emerge from Latin America. But this is particular because it's not privately owned, it's publicly owned. And we see the phantom of corporatization in many, many other public companies throughout Latin America and throughout the South, obviously also in Europe. Public enterprises that are public only in name. So if we talk against privatization, we also have to talk against corporatization. So let's go to the good guys in the energy sector. And the first good guys are the people and the struggles against privatization. In Latin America, there has been a lot of struggles against privatization, not only in the electricity sector, but also and most visibly in the water sector. That's why I decided to put this picture. I guess you all heard about the water struggles in Cochabamba, in Bolivia, and maybe you heard about the water referendum in Uruguay, in my country. In 2004, the Uruguayans went against to the ballot box, and by referendum, we decided to change the constitution to declare that water was a human right and therefore could only be provided by the state on a non-market basis. And the other good guys are obviously the alternatives to privatization. In our book, we identify many alternatives to privatization in Latin America. I'm going to talk a bit about that in a minute. But we also found alternatives in Europe. I guess you heard about what is going on in Berlin, where the citizens of Berlin are trying to build a new kind of energy company that is ecological, social, and democratic. And the funny thing is that they are fighting against another public enterprise, another state-owned enterprise, which is Vattenfall from Sweden. So I think this is quite important. These three words that define this campaign in Berlin, ecological, social, and democratic, because very much define the kind of energy that we want as a real alternative in this sector. So, coming back to the issue of alternative to privatization, this is the book that we published, and it's quite a thick book. It's more than 600 pages. So it seems that we found a lot of alternative to privatization. Unfortunately, not everything that we describe as an alternative is such an alternative. But maybe it's for you to think about. The book is downloadable for free on the TNI website and on the MSP website. Maybe we discuss too much. Maybe we idealize what an alternative is, and we tend to be too critical with our own projects, our own proposals. But the funny thing, the good thing, is that there are real alternatives. And there are also real processes of renationalization and remunicipalization. This is another book that we published. And in order to understand what is an alternative, we identify in the MSP 11 criteria, which are the ones that appear there. Obviously, I don't have time to explain in detail each one of these elements, each one of these criteria, but these are the ones that we use to measure what could be an alternative and what wouldn't be an alternative. Obviously, when we look at the case of Empresas Públicas of Medellin, the Colombian company I mentioned before, it is a public company, but it doesn't comply with many of these sectors. For instance, when we look at the environmental record of this company, it's quite nasty. And we also develop a typology to define what could be an alternative. And we found three possibilities. The first one are public entities. We find plenty of good, state-owned, well-managed, efficient, even environmentally friendly, socially controlled public enterprises. There are such kind of enterprises, and not only in the north, also in the south. The other was non-profit entities. Companies which are not state-owned, but are still public. And then we have a nice development that can be understood as partnership between the state and the non-market sector. But obviously, we all want this, the ideal energy alternative, which doesn't exist in the real world. But we are getting closer, at least in terms of idea. And we already know what we want. We want people's access. We want energy that is not produced to respond to the needs of the market or the needs of big private transnational corporations, as it happens in some countries. For instance, in the case of South Africa, there is a public company, Eskom, but more than 70% of the energy produced by Eskom goes to solve the needs of private companies. For instance, huge aluminum smelters that consume a lot of energy. So we want energy for the people, not for a private company. We also want energy that is publicly owned. And this can mean state-owned in some cases, and in other cases could be other forms of public, which is not necessarily a state-based. We also want small-scale alternative, as much as possible. Obviously, if we have a good, efficient national grid that is working well, as it happens in my country, we are not proposing to dismantle that. We want to democratize the national public company. But as much as possible, we want to develop a small-scale alternative. Also, climate-friendly, that's quite obvious. Locally produced, that's also quite important because there are plenty of examples of renewable forms of energy generation that seem to be friendly with environment, but they are not so friendly with the people. For instance, in Mexico, there are some examples of wind farms that had meant land grabbing and had meant going against the decisions and the wills of the local people. And obviously, we want a fair labor, a decent working condition for the workers of the electricity company. But let me finalize saying that I tend to concentrate in my research on state-owned utilities, on public utilities. And when we look at state companies, public companies, we tend to find that this company have at the same time this characters. They are good, but they are also bad sometimes, and they are quite ugly sometimes. And we have to remember that. And in Latin America, we have plenty of examples of such a company. For instance, in Mexico, there is a huge company that has done a lot to provide a real alternative, real solution to the energy needs of the Mexican people. This is the Comisión Federal de Electricidad. Also in Electrobras, this company has been quite efficient. If we look up, if we talk about the environmental record of Electrobras, the story would be totally different. ICE, which I think is quite close to a model public company. This is from Costa Rica. This company runs not only electricity services, but also telecom services. And is competing in the telecom sector with two giants such as Telefónica of Spain and Carlos Slim of Mexico. And they are still the favorite company of the Costa Rican people. And another quite nice state-owned company, which is UTE, the electricity company, state-owned of my own country and Uruguay. And here, let me finish with some data about electricity coverage of Latin America. And this graph by itself goes against every argument against privatization. Because when we look at the countries that didn't privatize, we see that those countries have practically universal coverage of electricity sectors. And they did it without relying on the private sector, without relying on privatization. So it is not true that you always need privatization to solve the energy problem. And the data from Latin America shows that. There are many countries in Latin America that didn't privatize the electricity sector, and those tend to be the ones that are quite close to universal coverage of services. There are also municipal companies, regional companies, as I already mentioned. For instance, this is a huge company from one state in Brazil, Copel, from the state of Paraná. And once again, EPM of Colombia, which I already mentioned, which is a model company in terms of efficiency, a model company in terms of quality of services, but more and more tends to behave like any transnational corporation as it evolves. And I'm not gonna take much time because I already talked about 20 minutes, but there has been also renationalizations in Latin America. Not everything that you heard as renationalization is really renationalization. For instance, in the case of Argentina in the year 2012, the government nationalized part of the shares of one Spanish transnational corporation, Repsol. But this year, the same government said, OK, maybe we kicked out the Spanish, but let's call the Americans to help us. And they invited Chevron to help them get the oil out. In the case of Bolivia, electricity has been renationalized, but not everybody is happy about that. We could talk later about that. And in the case of Venezuela, also electricity has been renationalized in totally in the year 2007, but the quality of the services is quite debatable, I would say, and I guess Edgardo can talk a lot about that. So I'm just gonna finish to say that we really have to understand what renationalization could be and what really is in practice, because it's not always what they look. This is what the newspaper published about renationalization in Bolivia. But when we go in detail to discuss what really happened, the picture is a bit different. And finally, this is my last slide. We need to do a lot of research about non-state actors, because public, I'm a defender of the state, but I'm also a critic of the state, and I accept that public doesn't always have to mean state-driven or state-owned. And within the MSP, we just began to do research about that, but we know that we know quite little about this, and there is plenty of room for further research in this area. So thank you, and these are just some websites that I can pass you later with some useful links on alternative. Thank you.